Do it. Come on. Come on. Open up your mouth. Tell God today, I'm available to you. Lift it up all over this room. Come on. If you're watching on iHeart, lift up your voice and just tell God, I'm available. Come on. Do it. 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 Thank you, God, for your blood. Thank you, God. Thank you that it covers every pain, every heartbreak. It makes me who I am. We wear your blood with pride today. Lift up your hands and just begin to honor him. Come on. Yes. Come on, we can be louder than that. We can be louder than that. We stand available. We stand available. Here we are. We want to hear from you today, God. Speak. 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 We're listening. Speak. This morning is such an honor to stand and welcome for the first semester the Valor Christian College Chorale. Put your hands together. Come on.
Yeah. storage is empty, and I am available to you. Come on, if that's your prayer, sing it to the Lord. Say, my storage is empty. My storage is empty. It's beautiful. And I am available to you.
To the one who is worthy, our hearts are ready, Lord.
desperate, Lord, for a touch from you. Say,
you don't come, we won't move. We're desperate, Lord, for a touch from you.
Sing it from your heart. Say,
you don't come, we won't move. We're desperate, Lord, for a touch from you.
Lift it up, say, you don't come,
we won't move. We're desperate, Lord, for a touch from you. If you don't come, we won't move. We're desperate, Lord, for a touch from you.
We dare.
We sing. We worship.
You are King.
You are King.
We are here for you.
We give everything to the one who is worthy.
together. We're gonna go back just a little bit. We're gonna have a little fun. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. We will shout and proclaim the greatness of your holy name. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. Say you are holy. Come on, put your hands together. When I think about this song, we did it last year, I think it was, wasn't it, Miss Lisa? We did this for the CD. And in the process of that, God started talking to me about this song. And I honestly forgot about it until just now. But my best is better than anybody can do because it's my best. And all that God wants is your best, individually and as a union, as a body of Christ.
Come on, Josh.
And so, I'm not gonna point fingers, I'm not gonna tell on anybody, but some of us out here, we're singing, we pour out our best, but we're going. Listen, God's done too much for me for that to be my best. Not everybody knows this, but over the summer, my dad had a seizure. And over 5 years ago, he had a bleed on the brain, and he wasn't medically pronounced dead, but all of his organs shut, and the only thing that was keeping him alive, he was brain dead, all of his organs shut, but the thing that was keeping himself was alive with a breathing machine and a medicine that keeps your heart pumping for 24 hours. And he was dead for 17 hours and came back to life. And so when this happened this summer, and he went and had the seizure, I was down there, and I was really nervous. And I just went back in time to when I was 15. Whew, it's been 10 years, thank God. Goodness, sorry, God's good. Anyways, so this was going on, and he ends up coming out of it. But I got to thinking about it. We didn't just sit there and do nothing. And we didn't just pray some little cute prayer. Somebody's life was on the line, and that was my father's. So I had to give my best. Some of us here are having things go on back home, and you're wondering, what's going on? Why is this happening? And it's distracting you from doing what it is God's called you to do when he called you to be here. But I want you to know that if you just pour out your best, God will do his best to take care of you. He can only do as much as you do. We have a saying back home in my parents' churches, try to outgive God, I dare you. Now we're not giving an offering. We're not doing that. But we are giving our praise. We are giving our worship. We are giving our all. We are giving our best. And I know most of us in this room, God has done too much for us for this to be our best. Because a lot of us have the same thing that's going on in their family that's going on in my family. And I want you to know that if you just let loose just a little bit. I was praying before we started church, and I said, God, I want the same spirit that was in the upper room to hit this place today. I want there to be a sound that sounds like a rushing mighty wind. And I want it to be a new beginning of Pentecost. A new Azusa Street, if you will. The next Azusa Street. Because let's be honest, we are the remnant. And if we are the remnant, it's time for us to stand up. So we have to give our best if we're going to stand up. Otherwise, what we're doing now is completely null and void. So this is what I want us to do. We're going to sing this again. We're going to go to the bridge. And we're going to start low like we normally do. But when we go up, I want this place to erupt like you just got the best call from your house. Because you gave your best. All right? Say, we pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. It's coming. We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. Say, we pour.
We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you.
We pour out our best for you. Come on, pour out your best.
We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you.
Here we go.
Pour out our best
for you. Go nuts and say, we pour out.
the school of the Spirit. Somebody just take 10 seconds and thank God that you're not broke, that you're not burdened, but you are a world changer. God is about to stir the greatest revival mankind has ever known through you. Look at somebody on your left and just tell them right now, revival is in my bones. No, see, you don't understand. The world's about to be changed through you. God didn't bring you someplace for you to die. God brought you someplace so that you can live. God didn't bring you through the hell so that you can stay in the pit. God brought you to a place where a new life can spring up so this world will know Jesus. If you've got a praise, get it. It's good to be home. Before we get started, because I have a feeling that God's going to do some things in this place today, I feel Elder G, Miss Ashton, the same thing you guys have been telling me on the phone. See, I'm still connected with you here in spirit because there's a legacy that lives in me through our pastor. There's been an impartation in my life. And Pastor, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for every opportunity. I want to thank you for seeing something in me that I didn't see in myself. And I honor you today, sir. I would not be the man that I am today without you. When you stand, I stand. And when you fight, I fight. Revival, sir, isn't distant. The revival is alive right here in this heart. Because of the revival in your heart. You, sir, are my general. And I will go anywhere you go. And I will fight and put my back to your back. And we will see the greatest outpouring of the Holy Ghost humankind has ever seen. And I believe, sir, you are a catalyst. And I thank you and I honor you today. Come on, if you appreciate the sacrifice of our general. Oh, come on, somebody. If you appreciate the sacrifice of our general who's laid awake praying for your future, who's relentless in his pursuit of God. I would not be the man I am today if it wasn't for that man. And I thank him every day that I wake up. God is doing something in this place. I feel the same spirit that quickened me when I was an 18-year-old kid, Elder G. All I knew was I had a call of God on my life. All I knew was I loved Jesus with everything I had, and I didn't know much other than that. But I knew that I had to come to a place where there was a giant killer and I had to get an impartation on my life. And some of you have come here with that same heart, that same desire. I don't know what I'm doing here. I don't know how to get there, but I'm here because I know that God's put something deep down on the inside of me. All that God is looking for is a vessel that is completely His, and when He finds it, He can change the world. He can change the world. Somebody shout at the top of your lungs, I am a world changer. Come on, somebody say it. When you begin to say it beyond the doubt and the unbelief. Say it beyond your past. Say it behind, beyond what it is that they said about you. Somebody say it down depths of who you are. I am a world changer. Now praise God, because He thought enough of you to put you in this place, in this season, right here, right now. I want to say hello to my lovely wife. She's crammed up in an office right now, putting this wonderful place on a laptop. Thank God for iHarb.tv. This is a place that touches the world. From this spot. What's up, girl? I'll see you later. Listen, I love my wife. And if you've seen me and you've seen her, you know I hit way out of my league. So I got a praise to put on it. Just don't mind me while I do, just for a moment. For some, this was World Harvest Bridal College back in the day. I am one that came, saw, and conquered. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Got the t-shirt and the ring to prove it, so you better watch out. If you want to put a ring on it. Yeah, I did that. I did that. And then we have three beautiful babies in it. I did that too. Oh, God is so good. I want us to get into the Word, if we can, just for a moment, because I really do believe that God has a Word in this house for you. We could stay in this atmosphere all day long, and I'm telling you, there are miracles, signs, wonders happening in the midst of us right now. But I believe that we're about to step into something. Heaven's about to invade us like never before. So what I want you to do is I want you to find your way back to your seat. I want you to give about five people a high five and say, get ready. This place is about to explode. And God is about to do what only He can do. Don't leave me, music. Come on, don't leave me. Y'all know that. Come on. Y'all gonna be playing a lot today, so just get ready. While you're standing, I want you to honor a forerunner in this house, a true daughter of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. One that has a pursuit to see God in everything that she does. And I always want you to give love to the one and the only, Miss Ashton Parsley. You've opened something up here that can't be closed, sister. And I have a feeling heaven's about to invade this place. Because of your sleepless nights, because of your prayers, because you fasted, because you sought the Lord. And I'm just telling you, I'm just glad to be on the team in any capacity. So if you get me cleaning toilets, I'll gladly clean the toilets. But I'm just glad to see the school of the Spirit be the school of the Spirit. And it wouldn't be so without the heart of Miss Ashton Parsley, Elder G, Miss Lisa, those of us that have come before you, Dr. Turpin, your amazing leadership team, Miss Sharice Conley, Pastor Ed Ramirez. I mean, you guys have some, as we say it back in Kansas City, you got some dogs leading the charge. And these dudes and ladies and people know how to get a hold of God, because we've got something to do in this end time generation. Amen? Amen. Remain standing for the reading of the Word of God. Remain standing. If you have your Bibles, open it real quickly to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. If you have it on the big screens, go ahead and throw it up there for those that were disobedient and did not bring their Jubilee Bible to chapel today. You are pardoned. You are forgiven. We've helped you out to give you a little love. Thank God for technology. But don't Facebook during this chapel service, or I'm going to come punch you in the face. Matthew 11, 12. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. Lift your hands. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Your kingdom come, your will be done today, here, now. Lord, I pray today that you move beyond me. Let my words have the backing of heaven, and let us move into the purpose that you've placed in each of us. Let us see with clarity the will of God in our lives. Satan, we bind you. Doubt, we bind you. This is the place that God has called us to be. But not just to be, but to become. And so, Lord, right now we just ask that you fill this room. Heaven touch earth now in Jesus' name. If you believe that he's in this place, if you believe that he's good, put those hands together and give God a mighty shout of praise. You may be seated. Do I got any single people in the room? Come on, if you're single, lift your hand. Look around. Don't leave me, music. Come on now, fellas. Look around. Just look around. Look around. I just became your wingman and just let you know who's available on the market. But I'll let you know that you need to keep your focus where it needs to be. God didn't call you to Bible college for you to boo up and for you to get that A. He is your bae before anything else. That's why I came to the School of the Spirit, and it just happened to be an extra bonus that I was able to get a hold of the most amazing woman that I ever met in my life. When you put your focus where it needs to be, God will show up in ways that are far superior than yours. Trust me, I would have been lucky to get an ogre for a wife. But I got the princess. I got the queen. And so I thank God for it. But listen, don't come here distracted. This is free right now, all right? This is free. Trust me, I sat in the seats that you sit. And I know the fight that you fight. And I know the struggles you go through. But I guarantee it's worth it. If you can endure through this season, you will see God in ways that you can only imagine now in this moment. You'll walk into places, you'll do things, and you'll be like, why am I here? Why am I in the room? Who am I? But God says, you are the chosen vessel. But you got to keep your focus. You got to keep your head on right. You got to keep fixed forward in what it is that God has for you. Like I said, that was just free. I just want to give that to you, because sometimes we get here in the first semester, first couple weeks, we get them fluttery. We saw her praising and worshiping God, and we said, that is my wife. And she said, that is my Boaz. He ain't your Boaz. He's a broke-ass. Thank you, Clint Brown. Can we just keep it real? I miss you guys. I miss you guys. Elkhart, Indiana. I know there's some folks watching in Elkhart today. I love you guys, and man, God is doing some amazing things. And let's just get ready. Next level living starts right now. I got my guy over here, Eli. Eli, just wave at me, buddy. He's from Elkhart, Indiana. Let him know that you love him today. I love that guy. I'm telling you, he's got a testimony of deliverance, of God just showing up and doing some amazing things. And I can't wait to see what it is that God does in him. And he's going to be coming to Valor soon, I believe. God's going to make a way. We know where to send him. We know where to send him. We know where to send him. Back to the text. Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. And we're going to break this thing down. We're going to get into expository preaching today. And we're going to get in this word, and we're going to get it down deep in our soul so that we can do something for the kingdom of God. Because there's a lot of people out there that aren't really doing much. There's a lot of chatter, but no doing. There's no action. There's nothing that's happening in this world. And I'm just here to tell you, we are living in the final days. And this is the church's greatest moment. You can easily look to the news and look to all the chaos and the craziness and can easily get distracted and say, oh God, let's go hide out and let's just go pray and let's do nothing to affect change. But that's not what we came to the kingdom for. We came to the kingdom to tear down the works of the enemy. And there's something that's in us that's greater than what's against us. We've got this fight, baby. We don't need nothing else. We got Jesus and what it is that he did. So don't just be one that goes out filling the world with noise. Be one that comes and brings change and brings the power of God in this world. So we're going to get into this because I believe this is a right now where we are, where we're going, what we're doing, why we're here. From now, let me just stop right there. I feel my pastor on me. Now, henceforth, and hereafter. From now to the days of John the Baptist, the kingdom of God has suffereth violence, and the violence take it by force. There's something about the moment that you live in right now. History and all of the heroes of our faith, I believe, would trade their stories and their legends to swap places with you right now. John the Baptist ushered in the beginnings of the new covenant. He wasn't the new covenant, but he came for one purpose and one purpose only, and that was to prepare the way of the coming Messiah. And something happened when John the Baptist stepped on the scene. Creation, if you would, began to awaken because they knew something was happening in the earth. But from the days of John the Baptist until this moment in which we stand right now, creation is groaning. Creation is groaning for the manifestation of the sons and the daughters of God. And if we're not careful, we'll do what many of our contemporaries have done, and we will have misplayed this moment. What happens far too often is when we get a call of God in our life, we look at the what. Well, I got a call of God in my life to be a preacher, and that's what I am going to do. I've got a call of God in my life, and I'm called to be a worship leader, and that's what I'm going to be. The what is great, but the what is not what's important. I can be a servant in the nursery, but what's mostly important is my why I am here, not what you do. Your what just opens you up for the opportunity for your why to shine forth. John the Baptist was one that was in the wilderness crying loud, sparing not. He wasn't concerned about popular opinion and looking for the title of the next big preacher. In fact, he rejected that more than anything. When they would come to him and ask him, are you, what are you? He didn't tell them what I am. He said, why I'm here. Right. Why I'm here is what's important. And why we're here is not so that we can be the next what, but so that we can prepare the way of the Lord. Your what is secondary. And when we focus on the what, we never accomplish the why. We focus on the what because it feeds our flesh. We want people to think that we've got the gifts and we've got the talents and we got the goods. And look at what I am. Look at what I got. You ain't got nothing. Let me just help you for a little bit. If it wasn't for the grace of God, your tail wouldn't even be sitting in these seats right now. But thank God he thought enough about you to not only put a what on you, but to give you a why. And your why is to see the kingdom of God everywhere your footsteps. My why is not to promote Manny Gonzalez ministry. Your why is not to be the next big praise and worship leader, because the word of God says that he rejects the proud. And so many of us get so consumed with pride when we focus on the what. I could care less what talents you have. What's your heart like? Because your talent's not going to move mountains. Your talent's not going to cast out devils. Your talent's not going to do anything in this earth. Your talent's going to sit there. But when you get a why in your belly and you understand, I was put on this earth to cause the gates of hell to suffer. When I wake up, you better watch out, devil. I got something in me that's about to destroy every yoke of bondage. I woke up this morning with revival in my bones. And it doesn't matter if I'm back in the nursery, I got revival. It doesn't matter if I'm back scrubbing toilets, I've got revival. It doesn't matter. I got a why. You got a why. You got a why. Why did God choose to pluck you up and put you in this season? So that you can show off what you got in your goods. We got too many people wasting their opportunity. We got too many people who have front row seats to the last days, watching as this thing passes us by. I didn't just come here to get front row seats to this thing. I came here to play the main role in this thing. And the main role doesn't mean I have to have my name on the title. The main role means that I've been part of a generation that's a nameless and faceless generation. I don't need to be recognized for my talent. I've got the goods because I've been able to get a hold of heaven. And I'm able to push. See, we oftentimes, I don't know about you, but I do this sometimes. I'm going to think, with the movie of my life, who would play me? Now, I know in the movie of my life, Jessica Alba would definitely be cast as Hannah. You can tell I've been away from my wife for a few days. She'd definitely be Jessica Alba. Now, you may be thinking Kevin James. I'm thinking Brad Pitt for yours truly. But see, ain't that just like us? We try to choose our role. We try to choose our role. I try to choose my role and who God wants me to be in this thing. Listen, here's the deal. I'm the supporting cast. He's the main cast. And I ain't pointing to L or G. I'm pointing to the B-I-B-L-E. I'm pointing to the Word, because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I'm pointing to the one who is and is to come. He's the main role. I'm just a supporting character in this thing. And some of you want to be the main. You ain't called to be the main. You called to support the why. And the why is critical. Because if we're going to accomplish what it is that God's put in our hearts to accomplish in this end time generation, we've got to get our focus off of ourselves and onto the vision, onto the mission. Why? To prepare the way of the Lord. You may have heard me say this before, but I truly do believe it. The same way that Jesus came into the world the first time is through the Spirit of God, he raised up a John the Baptist. A voice crying out in the wilderness. Now, you got to understand J the B, John the Baptist. John the Baptist should have been Dr. Turpin in the school of ministry because his father was of the priestly sector of the society. His father, high priest. Now, that position wasn't something that you applied to and hope they gave you a call back and you got accepted. That position was given by way of inheritance. And so, therefore, John the Baptist ought to have been pushed into the Pharisee and Sadducee school of thinking. But the Spirit of the Lord drew John the Baptist out to the wilderness. Let me just help you right here, right now. There are going to be times where you're here at Valor, where you feel like you're in the wilderness, where you feel like you're all alone and you're all by yourself. But it's in the wilderness something's formed on the inside of you. It's in the wilderness that you realize, greater is he that lives inside of me. See, sit down. Let me talk. I've been waiting for this for a while. Yeah, I'm staying on pews, hey. Jesus. Let's just talk about the wilderness just for a second. Jesus, when the call of God came upon his life, who was he with? Come on, know your word. John the Baptist. John the Baptist was the one that baptized Jesus. Heaven opened up. A dove came and descended upon him and said, this is my beloved son, who I am well pleased. Now, most of us would have stopped right there and thought we had arrived in ministry. I got the goods now. The Father has affirmed me. Here I am. What up, devil? But see, that's not what happened. The Father came, affirmed him in the midst of many. John the Baptist, front row seat, saw it. But what happened next? Did he go and he cast out devils? Did he go and heal the lame and the blind? Did he go to the cross? Did he resurrect from the dead? Where did he go? The wilderness. Don't be afraid when the call of God comes on your life that you are driven to a place that is wild. Because it's in the wild that you gain something that you need. I was born in the wild. I wasn't born from your school of thought and your line of thinking. I was born of the Spirit. And so you want to get distracted just because you've been eating ramen noodles and your wilderness is so hard and you haven't talked to mama in a week and you want to tuck tail and run because it's hard and the snow baby is coming. And they said something about you that hurt your feelings because you have leadership that cares enough about you not to just give you a little patty cake, but to tell you the truth. And if you're jacked up, we're going to get in your mess and tell you, get your life right. But because you're in the wilderness, you can't stand up to temptation. And so therefore, how do you expect to make a difference in this world? Now is your moment. God brought you here, not by accident, not just because he thought it would be a good idea, but because creation is waiting on you. And the only way that creation can respond to your voice is if you've gone through the wilderness to find the Spirit of God. Why are you here? Why are you here? Look cute. Rub shoulders. Lights, cameras, action. Are you here to get a hold of something that can only be gained through the wilderness experience? Are you here to push? Are you here to persevere? Are you here to move forward? Or are you here just to play? I believe I'm in a room of world changers. History makers. Revivalists who are born of the Spirit. We don't live after the creed of this world. The church has compromised too much. It's time we bear the Nazarite vow again upon our hearts. And let me just meddle for a little bit. It may be meddling, but you still need it. Stop drinking. Why would you mess with something that can destroy your future? Do you not understand the Nazarites took a vow to abstain? Well, you don't understand. It's a new covenant. We can live and we can drink and we can have it and we can do it and it's okay because I ain't getting drunk. Who gives a flip if you're getting drunk or not? You're compromising your anointing. Anointing doesn't come because you got so close to the line. Anointing comes because you've set your life apart and consecrated yourself and got a hold of something that can only be gained through sacrifice. Just because you think you can have it doesn't mean you ought to have it. This world needs miracles, signs, and wonders. And how can they get miracles, signs, and wonders if I've given of myself to the evils of this world? Every time you put that on your lips, you sacrifice the anointing that you have in your life. Well, that's legalism. It ain't legalism. It's how you become a world changer. You want results that will impact this world? You gotta do things that heaven does. Well, Jesus drank wine. Shut your mouth. You don't even know what you're talking about. Jesus was a Nazarite. Come on. He took a vow to abstain. And because he was able to abstain, he was able to endure. You tweet that? Jesus was able to endure the punishment of the cross because he was able to abstain from the temptations of this world. So you think you can go ahead and tip your toe, you can dip your toe in the waters of compromise and still get a miracle. I'm just waiting for this to sink into your brains, get into your spirit. Stop dipping your toe in the waters of compromise. Because if you want to grab hold of it, if you want to see resurrection, if you want to see life, then you got to die. Die to yourself. Die to your wants. Die to what you think you ought to have. Die to what you think you need. Die! And when you die, that's when you live.
Amen.
But we keep buying this lie. And we keep putting our hand in temptation. Let me help you here right now. Let me help you here right now. Holiness is not hard. It's just not. It's all on what you think. It's all on what you think. Here's something, and this is really practical. It's going to help you out. When the weight of your future lays upon your soul, you won't be tempted by things that make your soul bankrupt. What do I mean by that? When I realize I've got more to reach out for than to hold on to, it changes how I move in this world. When I understand that my actions today impact lives tomorrow, I won't put my hand to sin, because the weight of my purpose lays upon my soul. You'll understand this once you have kids. My babies depend upon their daddy being a righteous man now if they want revival tomorrow. There are youth groups you're going to lead. There are churches you're going to pastor. There are going to be congregations that you're going to lead in the presence of God. And they need you now to live right, not wait to live right. Because if you can live right now, revival will come tomorrow. But here's the good news. Revival isn't distant. Revival is here now. So in my holiness, there is revival. When I live right, I have life. Thank you for getting that. I appreciate that. Just get you some. It's good. You getting something? I got through my introduction. Let's go on. One thing you've got to understand, there's a misconception in this world right now that grace, just sprinkle some grace on me and everything will be all right. Ooh, I'm living in grace. It's like mistletoe. You can get away with kissing the girl as long as you under the mistletoe. But you've got to understand the characteristics of grace. Grace is violent. No, grace is nice. Grace makes me feel good. No. Grace is violent. Grace didn't come so that you can stay in your sin. Grace came to push you out of the clutches of the devil. Grace is violent. Grace is violent. It destroys the work of sin in my life. Grace is violent. Come to patty cake and to make you feel okay living in sin. Grace came to push you out into greater things. Grace is violent. And here's the deal. We have allowed ourselves to go by the wayside of a theology that is sending our generation to hell. Passive grace. I get this under grace. And grace. I can be a homosexual and still have grace. Come on. I can have sex with whoever I want to. I have grace. I can do this and do that, but I still have grace. No, you can't. That's not how this thing works. But what passive grace does, hyper grace, whatever you want to call it, what it does is it opens the door
to sin and strongholds in our life. That's why you can still be in church, think you're okay, go out and sin and come back in and never have conviction, because somewhere along the lines you bought the lie that grace wasn't violent. Grace came to restore the order of the kingdom in your heart. Helping you. I'm helping you. Romans 5:20. Where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. Now for some, they think that means that sin and grace can coexist. Grace and sin cannot coexist. Amen. I'm helping you. Because where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. Now we think, well, here's sin, it's a little, but here's grace, it's big. No, 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 no. What you've got to understand is grace comes and swallows up and destroys sin. So where there is sin, grace comes and destroys the works of sin, the fruit of sin in our life. Grace and sin cannot coexist. That's why we must be people that have hold of the amazing grace that is found in Jesus Christ. You've got to have a hold of it. And not just some weak little, well, I'm just going to take grace when I need it. You grab grace. You take grace every day when your eyes pop open. Violent, take it by force. The Bible says that the love of God knows no boundaries, no height, no depth, no angel, no demon. It's constantly in pursuit of you. Grace is searching you out. Grace is violent and it comes to destroy. But you've got to open your heart. Stop being timid about your calling. Stop being timid about the purpose God's placed on your life. Don't approach your calling with timidity, but be bold as a lion. Come with all you've got. Stop filling heaven with empty prayers, full of vain emotion. Stop it. Stop it. Oh my God, if you would please let me, please, I want to please. Stop filling heaven with empty prayers and vain emotion. Well, how should we pray? Your kingdom come. Yeah. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. From the days until John the Baptist. Until now, the kingdom of God suffereth violence. And the violent take it by force. Elder Shermer, RD, Elder G, come up here. Grab that board. The kingdom takes it by force. Oftentimes we read the scripture and we are so confused, because when we receive violence, we think violence is, oh, evil, no, hands up, don't shoot, hey. But you've got to understand what the context of the scripture is. The violent take it by force. The kingdom of God suffereth violence. The kingdom of God suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. Suffereth violence. In the Greek dictionary, hold that board up. Hold that board up. Artie, since you got the hammer, you got a nail? You got a nail? You got it? Okay. Bring it over here. Get a camera. This is the biggest nail we got? Cool. Elder Shermer, you hold one side. Elder G, you hold one side. Artie, you got the hammer?
Mighty Thor.
This is going to help you out. This is going to help you out. This is going to help you out. The kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violence take it by force. It doesn't mean that violence against you and me.
Right.
It means violence against the kingdom of hell.
Come on.
And the principalities in this world. But violence comes in many different forms and fashions. If you've ever been into a delivery room, and I have three times, you know that's one of the most violent places on the face of the planet. It looks like a murder scene. I don't mean to scare any of you ladies, but it is cray. Lisa said, yes, it is. Say that. Don't say it again. Something's happening. When you come to Jesus, there is a violent burst of the kingdom.
Yeah.
The kingdom of heaven.
Right.
Suffereth violence. And the violent take it by force. Now, suffereth violence is pretty amazing. The Greek dictionary says it means to crowd oneself into. To crowd oneself into. So when you understand what the kingdom's trying to do, the kingdom of God is coming to force itself into this world.
Right, right.
The violence. Suffer the violence. But the violence, take it by force. Let me just give you this illustration. Artie, take that nail. Now, let me hold up.
He works alone.
What occupies this right here, from here to here? What occupies it? Wood. But when I get in the right place, is it getting in you? Are you in the right place? When I get in the right place. That's the first thing that you've got to understand, is you've got to be positioned in the right place for the kingdom to come in you, to come through you. You've got to position your place in a position of holiness, a position of consecration, in a position where now you've been aligned with heaven. The reason why some of us aren't seeing things happen, we're seeing the enemy occupy our mind. We're seeing the enemy occupy our family. We're seeing the enemy occupy our future, our purpose. It's because we're not in the right place. God, I feel this in my bones. But the moment you get in the right place, take that. Now you are positioned for heaven to suffer violence. For heaven to force itself through you. Heaven. 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 So in order for my life to make an impact against the gates of hell, I have to position my life with heaven. Jesus didn't just come to get you into heaven. Jesus came to get heaven in you.
Yeah.
Right.
Good. Take it. The kingdom of God suffereth violence.
The kingdom is trying to force itself into your world. But the only way that can happen is when you align with heaven, and then the violent take it by force. So when heaven begins to take it, and heaven begins to align, and heaven begins to move, heaven begins to operate in your life, you begin to get a prayer life back. You begin to get a worship back. You begin to get praise back. You begin to live your life with holiness back. You begin to do things. Now all of a sudden, heaven is crushing and pushing itself into your world. The kingdom of God suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. Heaven is now occupying. What occupies this space right now? We just said wood. But when the violent take it by force, what's occupying now? The nail, no longer the brokenness of yesterday. No longer your discouragement, no longer your failures, because now all of a sudden heaven has taken it by force, and heaven has pushed itself, has crowded itself into your world. And so no longer does the enemy occupy your mind. Now that's on a personal level, but what about on a regional level? In a generational level. Once we understand this for ourselves, then we can begin to take it into our regions. Then we can begin to take it into the world. Heaven wasn't meant to be separate from the world, but heaven was meant to be here through the kingdom of God. Through us. So now that you understand that heaven is constantly, now you've got heaven's backing on your words. And now you can begin to storm the gates of hell and begin to take principalities and regions. So when you walk into a place, no longer does the enemy occupy, because I've positioned and aligned myself with heaven, and the violent take it by force. So Elkhart, Indiana, watch out. The kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. Where you come from, who you are, where you've been, your family. Stop putting up with the tricks of the devil. Take it by force. Shout for 10 seconds because you know God's about to do something. Somebody get violent! Somebody push until heaven enters your life! Hit it again, Artie. Hit it again. The kingdom is forcing itself into the world through willing vessels that have aligned themselves and positioned themselves with the kingdom. The eyes of the Lord are searching throughout the earth, looking for a vessel that is completely His. Creation is groaning for the sons and the daughters of God to be revealed. It's time we allow heaven to force itself into our earth, into our situations.
Yes.
But what is the violent? The kingdom of God suffers violence. And the violent, that's you. And that's me. What does it mean to be violent? The Greek dictionary. Those who strive to obtain the privileges of the kingdom with earnest, eager effort. There needs to be a sincerity that comes back to our hearts. Yeah. We've got to get to the point where we mean business. Yeah. About the kingdom.
Right.
We mean business about the kingdom, and we get tired of hell occupying our worlds. And we take the privileges of the kingdom and we begin to unleash it on everything that exalts itself above the name of Jesus. That means that the privilege of healing comes back.
Right.
When the kingdom takes it by force. Oh God. Somebody begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Oh, come on, somebody pray in the Holy Ghost. There's about to be a force. There's about to be a force that breaks through. Every generational curse in your life. There's about to be a force that breaks through every bondage in your life. There's about to be a force that reaches into your future. Heaven touching earth. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Fervent, 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 fervent. Hey, shake. Oh God. Oh God. Take it by force. Take it by force. Take it by force. Take it by force. Earnest, eager effort. Fervent, dedicated, sincere. I mean business. Reason why you keep getting beat up by the devil and ate up by your enemy is because you don't know violence anymore. But you've got to understand down deep within your spirit, there's a violent man, a violent spirit ready to annihilate. Get violent with it. Get violent with it. Get violent with it. Press. Push. Get up out of your seat. Get down here. Get violent with it. Get violent with it. Get violent with it. Get violent with it. You're being too cute. You're being too cute. You're being too cute. This is where the curse stops. This is where the curse stops. The violent, take it back. Raise your voice, Zion. your kingdom
Let heaven occupy. Get your focus off
Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come. Your family set. Take it by force. You want anointing for a generation. Take it by force.
We're going to do something here in just a second. C.S. Lewis said, if I find in myself desires which nothing in this world can satisfy, if I find in myself desires which nothing in this world can satisfy, the only logical explanation is that I was made for another world. The only logical explanation is I was made for another world. You can be in this world and not of this world. If you're ready to receive power, I mean real power, power from on high. Pastor Manny's been talking this whole time. The violent take it by force. Warfare is not cute. Warfare is not complacent. Warfare is not satisfied. Warfare is not something that you operate in out of a timid heart. The violent take it by force. Some of y'all in here need to get as violent with the enemy as he's been getting with you. Some of y'all have been beat up, tore down, tore up, ripped apart by the enemy. Your family's been torn apart, your finances, your mind. The enemy has come in like a violent force in your life. And you're just standing there taking it. Put up your dukes, baby, and pray. That's how you win this fight, is you pray. You pray violently. You pray with the strength and the might that the Spirit of God has birthed on the inside of you. You gotta get mad at the devil today. Destroy you. Tired of seeing the enemy take your family members. Well, get violent today then. You want something to raise up on the inside of you when the enemy comes in attacking you and going to war with you that goes,
Remandarabo, Remasandarabo, Correme Shete, Mandarabasandayarabo, Sondo, Men
again. You'll never doubt again. Yes, it's you. Yes, it's you. Yes, it's you that he's called. Yes, it's you that he's anointed. Yes, it's you that he's placed a mantle upon to win a generation. It doesn't belong to Joshua. It belongs to you. 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 Lay hands on her, Miss Charisse. Lay hands on her.
Yeah.
I want to share this one last word. One last word, and we're about to unleash something on you. We're about to unleash something on you. Jeremiah 23. Jeremiah 23, verse 29. What we did in this place is we unleashed the word. The book is right. The book is right. And when you unleash the word, something happens. Is not my word like fire that consumes all that cannot endure the test, says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the most stubborn rock in pieces. My God, we're about to break some things off of your life. 10 people. Grab hands right now. 10. Only 10. Come on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Everybody else, except for those 10 that I just pointed out. We're about to unleash heaven. You get your focus up here. I'm about to pray heaven down on your life. I'm about to pray heaven down on your life. And like a hammer, the hammer is about to fall. 10, lift your hands. 10, lift your hands. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Stretch your hands towards this 10. Heaven, fall now.
Come on, this isn't a time to spectate. Everybody close your eyes, lift your hands, and begin to pray. Not a time to look. This is a time to pray. Come on.
Sounding on, gather the people. Sounding on, gather the people. Sounding on, the kingdom is here. Sounding on, gather the people.
Thank you for watching this live event from iHeart.tv.